And so I'll stand out here while I do that. When are we going to start
that? We're right now.
All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and get started. And so,
get rid of this thing.
Let me get Jacob, Jovi, Megan to pray.
Yes, Lord, I want to thank you for bringing us all here today safe. I want to thank you for the family that you provided for each and every one of us, and for your grace, for your mercy that none of us deserve. I thank you for your unfailing love and allowing us to be here and worship at your feet. I pray that the Holy Spirit fills this room and everyone in it, and that during the message, we all receive something from your word, which I know we will, and that throughout the rest of the night tonight and ongoing, that we all fellowship and we all have an edifying time together.
Amen. Lord Jesus, it's blessed to be here today. I just ask you to continue to build family, fellowship, unite us in one, so we can march for your glory. Praise you. You're the Most High. You're our King. Just continue to work in each and every one of us. Reign in your Holy Spirit. I hope someone leaves with a changed heart to them. Just continue doing what you do best. In your holy name, amen.
Jesus,
so I just want to read one verse before we get into the music tonight, as there's just been a longing on my heart over the last couple days of just this desperation to really want to be close to Jesus and be filled with His Spirit. And so there's this verse that's in Psalm 73 where He says, "Who am I in heaven? Whom have I in heaven but you? I desire you more than anything on earth." As we sit here right now, man, I know that I want my heart aligned with that as well. That as we sing these songs, we are just desiring Jesus more than anything right now. This closeness to consume Him, to be with Him.
Come, let us
What was cool today in Bible Hour, one thing that stood out as we were reading the Word is how often things were pointing to the cross. And something one of the guys was talking about, man, how this points to the cross, that we wouldn't lose sight of that. You know, how everything is pointing to Jesus and what we deserve, what He has done. We would set our eyes on that and understand the necessity of just really being at His feet and turning from self, man. And so this song invites us to remember what Jesus has done, remember what the cross really represents. You invite me.
Sometimes I lose sight of how precious the blood of Jesus is, man. And as I was praying into communion, this scripture, this passage you gave me just speaks about it, man. It's in 2 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 3. By His divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know Him, the one who called us to Himself by means of His marvelous glory and excellence. And because of His glory and excellence, He has given us great and precious promises. These are the promises that enable you to share His divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. In view of all this, make every effort to respond to God's promises. Supplement your faith with a generous provision of moral excellence, and moral excellence with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with patient endurance, and patient endurance with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love for everyone. The more you grow like this, the more productive and useful you will be in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But those who fail to develop in this way are short-sighted or blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their old sins. So, dear brothers and sisters, work hard to prove that you really are among those God has called and chosen. Do these things, and you will never fall away. Then God will give you a grand entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So let's just take a moment and thank Jesus for that precious blood. You will take communion as a family. Let's take communion as a family.
Because of Christ, I'm not forsaken. No.
16. It says, early the next morning, Joshua brought the tribes of Israel before the Lord, and the tribe of Judah was singled out. Then the clans of Judah came forward, and the clan of Zerah was singled out. Then the families of Zerah came forward, and the family of Zimri was singled out. Every member of Zimri's family was brought forward person by person, and Achan was singled out. Then Joshua said to Achan, "My son, give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, by telling the truth. Make your confession and tell me what you have done. Don't hide it from me." Achan replied, "It is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. Among the plunder, I saw a beautiful robe from Babylon, 200 silver coins, and a bar of gold weighing more than a pound. I wanted them so much that I took them. They are hidden in the ground beneath my tent, with the silver buried deeper than the rest." So Joshua sent some men to make a search. They ran to the tent and found the stolen goods hidden there, just as Achan had said, with the silver buried beneath the rest. They took the things from the tent and brought them to Joshua and all the Israelites. Then they laid them down on the ground in the presence of the Lord. Then Joshua and all the Israelites took Achan, the silver, the robe, the bar of gold, his sons, his daughters, cattle, the donkeys, his sheep, goats, tent, and everything he had, and they brought them to the valley of Achor. Then Joshua said to Achan, "Why have you brought trouble on us? The Lord will now bring trouble on you." And all the Israelites stoned Achan and his family and burned their bodies. They piled a great heap of stones over Achan, which remains to this day. That is why the place has been called the Valley of Trouble ever since then. So the Lord was no longer angry.
I gotta tell you guys, as we were singing that song, "How Precious is the Blood," I was thinking about my past life, and I was thinking about how if somebody would have came into one of the dope houses I was at, or if somebody would have came into one of the clubs that I hung out at, one of the party spots that I went to, and started singing that song, I was thinking about how many people would think that's so foolish. And even to this day, if you went there and you started doing that, so many people would think that that's silly. As we're singing about how precious is the blood of Jesus. And I would have been one of those people at that time. And I was just thinking about how Jesus clearly says in Corinthians that the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. And I was thinking about how many people would find that song foolish. And how many people would think that it's silly. But that the Holy Spirit can do this miracle. And this miracle can take place by the power of the Holy Spirit. And you would no longer think the cross is foolish, but you would know it's the very power of God. And I just found myself praying during that song that the Holy Spirit would do something like that here tonight. And I got to tell you, I've been praying for you guys today, and my prayer has been, well, not exactly, but my prayer has been that you would not have an easy day. That just sounds wrong, right? Is that not, you're not supposed to pray that for people, that they wouldn't have an easy day, but that's been my prayer for you guys today. Jesus made it clear, like, that should be my prayer for you guys today. Like, whoever was going to be here, some of you guys I didn't know was going to be here, my prayer for whoever would be here tonight, that you wouldn't have an easy day. And I didn't pray that. I didn't go, "Jesus, don't let them have an easy day." I prayed that you guys would follow Jesus. And Jesus goes, "If you follow me, it's not going to be easy." He says in Matthew 7, he says, no, that the road to life, the gateway to life, is narrow and the road is difficult. And only if you find it. So my first prayer was like, man, I hope that these people follow Jesus today. Jesus, I hope they follow you. So I hope that they don't have an easy day. Because if you followed Jesus today, you didn't have an easy day. And then the second part of that prayer was like, okay, and if they're not following you, Jesus, I hope they don't have an easy day. Because then they'll realize they need you. Lord. And if you're sitting here right now and you just had this easy day, I hope it stops right now. I hope that this is where you follow Jesus. And when you leave here, you follow him. But if you're sitting here right now, yeah, I didn't have an easy day. Well, praise Jesus. Because one of two things is happening. Either you were following him, and so it's been a difficult day. And that's why very few find it. Because most people just want the easy road. They want the wide, easy road. They wake up and they go, man, what can I do today to make my day easy? Let me plan out my day so it's not so hard for me today. What are some things I can do throughout my day today to make sure that it's easy for me? And Jesus goes, that's the path to destruction. So if you're sitting here right now and you didn't have such an easy day, you might be one of the blessed few that actually understands it, that's actually on the road to life. I saw you were having a tough meeting today. Praise Jesus. It's a grind to follow Jesus. It's a grind. He says that. But it's going to be short because this life's going to be over in a second. And what comes next lasts forever. So I hope you didn't have an easy day. If you didn't, chances are you were following Jesus. I'm picking up in the book of Joshua. You guys are going through this on Wednesdays or every other Wednesday. And what happened right before this, where he was reading about Achan's sin, is the Israelites were being defeated. God's people were being defeated. And, you know, Joshua's doing the good Christian thing, and he's praying on his face, and he's going, oh, what am, you know, why have you done this? Why are you doing this, God? And he goes, it's not me, it's you. Jesus goes, it's not me, it's you. He goes, there's somebody who stole some things that they weren't supposed to steal. They've taken some things that are mine, and they stole them. And he goes, and that's why you're not having victory, and that's where we picked up, where they're finding out who it is that did this. I don't know if you heard the name Brittany Griner. If you know anything about sports, you've heard that name. Because for about a year or so, she's a female pro basketball player that went to Russia, and she had a small amount of weed or marijuana in a vape cartridge, and she ended up getting arrested in Russia. And everybody was losing their mind because she got arrested in Russia, and they took her to court, and they gave her 9 years. Wow. 9 years for some weed, a small amount of weed and a vape. A little bit of marijuana, and everybody in the sports world, and everybody in America was losing their crap, and they were like, this is crazy, how can you do that to her? And this is wrong. This is so harsh. Because see, over here in America, that's not a big deal. Marijuana's not a big deal. In fact, we were just like, hey, you know what, why don't we just legalize that? Why don't we just let people do that? Because people are doing it when we told them not to do it anyways, and so let's just let them do it. Let's profit off of it. But it's not a big deal over here. And so since it wasn't a big deal over here, everybody thought that was crazy. 9 years? That's harsh. That's crazy. That's wrong. Let me ask you, how do you feel about Achan's punishment? Stole a robe, some silver coins, and a gold bar. And Jesus took him, his whole family, all his cattle. He said, don't even let his tent sit there. Take his tent. Take it all down to this valley and throw big rocks at them until they're dead. And if they're not dead, just set them on fire after that. And that's the punishment. Think that's wrong? Think that's harsh? Think that's too harsh? See, if you do, it's because you don't think sin's a big deal. You don't think Jesus' image and his glory is a big deal if you think that's wrong. And you think it's too harsh. just like people freaking out about that sentence. See, it's not a big deal. How could they do that? So wrong. It's too harsh. See, if you think that punishment that Jesus gives Achan is wrong or too harsh, it's because you don't really understand how big a deal sin is. Especially in our world. But what do? If people are going to keep doing something, we'll just make it okay. We just won't let it be a big deal anymore. We'll just make it okay. If you think it's too harsh, if you think it's wrong, you don't understand who he is. You don't understand how big a deal his glory is. This is the right penalty. This is the right punishment. This is the punishment that's deserved for cosmic treason against the king of the universe.
Word.
This is one of those passages that always puts me back in my place real quick. Wake up early in the morning, want to go sit and read the Bible and be alone with Jesus, and you start to read a passage like this, and when your first thought's like, man, that seems harsh, it's like, oh my God, there's something wrong with me. There's not something wrong with him. So it has to be me. See, this is one of those passages that puts you back in your place real quick. This is the right penalty. This is the right punishment for sin. And see, I can't convince you of that. Like, I can't stand up here and convince you that sin is as big a deal as it is. And that's why I was praying that the Holy Spirit would do that. Man, Lord Jesus, by your Spirit, would you convict us of sin? That we would really be convicted of how big a deal sin is? How big a deal your glory is. You think about the cross, you think about the crucifixion, and how it says, man, you could hardly recognize that he was a man. That Jesus was so mangled. It's a clear picture of how sin mangles the image of God. So that you can't recognize his image. And all of us are guilty of this. All of us are guilty of this same thing that Achan has done here. All of us have taken what belongs to him, what's for him, what is about his glory and for his glory, and made it about us. All of us are guilty of the exact same thing that Achan has done here. Do you really understand this? I mean, do you really understand this? Do you really understand that this is what sin deserves? This is the punishment that sin deserves. That apart from Jesus, this is still the punishment to come. Eternal death and fire. You understand that this is what you deserve. I was talking in Cleveland with the guys, and we were talking about, during leadership development, about thankfulness. You know, in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, it says, always be thankful. Be thankful in all circumstances. It says, because that is God's will for your life if you belong to Jesus. And here's the thing. People struggle so much with being thankful. I want you to leave here as somebody who is thankful in all circumstances. Because it's directly tied to being filled with the Holy Spirit. I can guarantee when you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, it's because you're not thankful. Everywhere in this book, it talks about being filled with the Holy Spirit. It talks about being thankful for everything. And being thankful in all circumstances. And thanking Jesus for everything. And so I want you to leave here as people that are truly thankful in all circumstances. And if I had to guess, most of you guys struggle with that. Let me tell you why. Because most of the time, you're trying to be thankful for what you have. And sure, should you be thankful for what you have? Absolutely. But true thankfulness isn't rooted in what you have. True thankfulness is rooted in what you didn't get. Do you see that? True thankfulness is rooted in what you didn't get. In what you deserved, but you didn't get. The same thing Achan got. That's why I love this. It goes, this is one of two places in the Bible that talks about this valley. And it says here that it's the valley of trouble. That they name it the valley of trouble. And in Hosea 2:15, Jesus makes a promise. He goes, I'll transform the valley of trouble into the gateway of hope. And Jesus is talking about the cross. That Jesus would take our punishment on the cross, and it would no longer be our valley of trouble, but it would be the gateway of hope. Because what's it say at the end here in Joshua chapter 7? The Lord was no longer angry. That Jesus on the cross would satisfy the wrath of God. He would take what we deserve, which is where true thankfulness is rooted, and what you didn't get. See, and that's how you really appreciate what you have. Only will you really be thankful for what you have and what Jesus has given you when you realize that it's rooted in Him not giving you what you deserved. Then you'll be thankful in all circumstances. Because you'll always be able to look at the valley of trouble and go, could be that. I know I'm having a tough day, but I'm not getting stoned and thrown in fire for eternity. So I'm thankful. You guys got to get this. You got to get this because it says, this is God's will for you if you belong to Jesus. That's what it's saying when He says He'll transform the valley of trouble into the gateway of hope. And right after that, in that same verse, in Hosea, He goes, and there, talking about His people, talking about His church, because he refers to us as her, the bride. He goes, there, she'll completely give herself to Me. See what He's saying? He's going, if you belong to Jesus, you completely give yourself to Jesus, that valley of trouble is now this gateway of hope because you belong to Him. But you have to completely give yourself to Him. And this is how you're going to experience the love of Jesus too. You'll never experience the love of Jesus until you understand that this is what you deserve. If you don't understand that this is what you deserve, that this is what sin deserves, that this is what you deserve for what you've done to Jesus in His glory and for sin, you'll never experience the love of Jesus. That's why there's been people that I've known for years that have been hanging around the church but aren't really the church. Because they've never fully experienced the love of Jesus because they won't admit this is what they deserve. They don't understand that this is what they deserve. And you'll never experience the love of Jesus if you don't really understand this. And so I just want to look at a couple things here because I want to look at why for Achan this was the valley of trouble and not the gateway of hope. Because it wasn't just because Jesus hadn't gone to the cross yet. It's Achan standing in this valley. Could have been anybody else, but it was Achan. And so I want to look at why this was the valley of trouble instead of the gateway of hope for Achan. And the first thing we see is that he only told the truth because he got caught. See, he didn't respond to conviction. And if you don't think there was conviction, you don't understand why he hid something. Of course there was conviction. You don't hide something unless you know it's wrong. So he didn't respond to the conviction. And he didn't have godly sorrow. He was more worried about getting caught. That's why he waited till the very end until Jesus singled him out all by himself, standing in front of him. The whole time, you know that he was sitting there going, "Man, I hope they don't find out it's me." See, worldly sorrow is all about trying not to get caught. And worldly sorrow is being angry because you got caught, or being upset because you got caught, or feeling bad because you got caught. But godly sorrow is knowing you're already caught. Because there's nothing that you could do that he doesn't see and already know. See, true fear of the Lord knows that you can't bury something that he doesn't know about. And that's godly sorrow, because you know that you already got caught. So you come forward and you respond to conviction. Because see, I'm telling you right now, at judgment time, it's too late. Because that's what's happening here, is it's judgment time for Achan, and it's too late. You're not going to stand in front of Jesus and go, "Oh yeah, okay, that's right, I did have this stuff buried, you caught me." It's not going to work that way. It's going to end just like it did for Achan. And he only told the truth when he got caught. And he didn't take lying serious, like Jesus does. He didn't think of lying as big of a deal as Jesus does. Like, Jesus takes lying very seriously. In fact, in Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 22, he says, "I hate lying lips, but I delight in anyone who tells the truth." He goes, "I hate it. Lying lips are detestable to me," is what he said. He goes, "I can't stand it." That being who created you and everything else sitting on the throne goes, "I'm disgusted when I see lying." Listen to what he says earlier in chapter 7 here in Joshua. He tells him in verse 11, "Someone's taken some of the things, someone's stolen some of the things that I commanded must be set apart for me." Listen, he goes, "And they have not only stolen them," as if that's not bad enough. He goes, "but they lied about it and hidden the things." He goes, "Listen, yeah, somebody stole some things." He goes, "but you know what else? They lied. They lied about it. And they're being deceitful because they're hiding it." And so Achan didn't take lying as serious as God does. That's why he says here, Joshua goes, "Man, it's time, it's judgment time." He goes, "Give glory to God by telling the truth." You understand the simplicity of that? That you're able to actually give glory to God by telling the truth, by being honest. You know why? Because in John chapter 8, Jesus goes, "The problem is that your father is the devil." And he goes, "He's the father of lies." And then what's Jesus say about himself in John chapter 14? He goes, "I'm the truth." Jesus goes, "I'm the truth." And so, of course, if you're children of Jesus, he goes, "Man, you'll be of the truth. You'll be children of the truth. You'll act as my kids if you're telling the truth." He goes, "but when you lie," he goes, "the devil's the father of lies." He goes, "and that's your father, and you're acting like his kids, and like you belong to him." This is why lying is such a big deal to Jesus, and this is why he takes it so serious. And I just think about how it must have been for Achan every night to go lay down in his tent, knowing beneath the surface that stuff was buried. I just wonder about you guys in this room tonight. Do you have anything buried? That when it's just you and Jesus at the end of the day, at the end of the night, and you're just laying there, in the quiet, it's just you and him. you got something buried that he knows about. And are you going to give glory to God by telling the truth? You going to respond to the conviction? It says here in verse 21, this is really important, because how did he get here? We see these things that are happening. We see that he only told the truth when he got caught. We see he just had worldly sorrow. We see that he didn't take lying serious. But how did he get there? And that's what it tells us here in verse 21. In verse 20 he says, this is true. In verse 21 he says, among the plunder I saw a beautiful robe from Babylon, 200 silver coins and a bar of gold weighing more than a pound. I wanted them so much that I took them, and they are hidden in the ground beneath my tent, with the silver deeper than the rest. You see the process here of how he got here? He said, I saw it, then I took it. Right? There's even something in between there. I saw it, then I wanted it, then I took it. See, it didn't start with sinful action. Before he took it, he saw it. Before he wanted it, he saw it. Do you understand how important it is what you're looking at? Do you really understand the importance of what you're focused on and what you're looking at? Because long before you do that thing, it's because you won't look away. It's because you keep looking at it. And then eventually there's this desire that starts to happen. And you find yourself wanting it more and more. And then you do it. And there's so many off-ramps there, guys. There's so many off-ramps there for you. But it can be handled way back in the beginning when you see it. This is why David in Psalm 27 in verse 4 goes, all I want to do is just stare at you. Like, I just want to stare at you. I just want to look at you, Jesus. I just want to meditate on you and your perfections. Because when I look down here and I see a beautiful woman across the way on a roof, and I keep staring, something bad happens. I start to really want that. And then I go and I take that. And then I'm trying to cover it up by killing people. I'm trying to hide it. And he's going, all I want to do is just stare at you. I just wonder if when we recognize our lust, right? Because this is what it's talking about. It's talking about coveting. And you go, okay, what is that? Some big Bible word? No, coveting just means to sit there and lust over something. To just sit there and look at it constantly and to constantly give in with your eyes. See, I don't think people understand a lot of times in James chapter 1, in verse 14, it says, temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. And these desires give birth to sinful actions. So we see it there. And when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. You see what it's saying? It's giving a picture of like somebody who's pregnant. And they're excited because they're going to have a baby. And there's all this joy. And I'm going, man, this is going to be the best thing ever. We're going to have this baby shower, and we're going to have this new baby, and I can't wait to have this baby to bring life into the world. But it's talking about in the context of sin. And in thinking, oh man, this sinful thing that I've been looking at that I desire so much, it's going to give me life, and it's going to give me pleasure, and I'm really excited about it. And then it's like that pregnant person or that pregnant couple having that baby being born dead. What you thought was going to be life, what you thought was going to bring joy, what you thought was going to bring pleasure, what you thought was going to make you so happy is this stillborn baby. It gives birth to death. And that's why it says in here in James, it goes, man, when sin is allowed to grow, when you nourish that, when you're taking your prenatal vitamins and you're nourishing that thing that you think is going to bring you life and joy and pleasure, but it gives birth to death. I just wonder, what would it be like if we would stop looking? If we, right there when it starts, go, no, no. I just want to look at you, Jesus. I just want to meditate on you. Like we know in Colossians 3, it goes, man, don't think about the things of heaven. Think about the things of this earth. But I really like in Philippians chapter 4, in verse 8, it says, now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about these things that are excellent and worthy of praise. But listen, I just want you to think about the first thing that it says. Fix your thoughts on what is true. See that? Because give glory to God by telling the truth. Fix your thoughts on the one who is the truth. Think about him. Because it starts with him going, man, I saw it and it looks so good. And as you know, I wanted it. Because then I took it. It gave birth to sinful action. And it gave birth to death. His death. His destruction. Another thing we see is that he didn't take church serious. You go, what? Is that really true? Absolutely. Listen to what it says here. Why have you brought trouble on us? The Lord will now bring trouble on you. See, your sin doesn't just affect you. And Jesus takes church serious. Because church just isn't this event. It's the people here with his spirit living in them. And he calls the church his bride. And just think if you knew some big, strong man from the streets, had a wife, and he left her with you real quick and goes, hey, keep an eye on my wife, I'll be right back. And when he walked away, you started beating on her. What do you think he would do when he got back? See, this is the church. He takes his church serious. And I just know that people that say they belong to the church don't take the church as serious as he does. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, this is what he says in verse 16. Don't you realize that all of you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you? And God will destroy anyone who destroys this temple. That's a promise. Oh, we love the promises of God. Do you love that one? He goes on to say, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. And so he goes, if you go around like, we're the temple, and we're actually, if we belong to Jesus and have the Spirit in us, you don't belong to yourself anymore. You belong to the Holy Spirit. And if you're not living holy and pursuing holiness, I love that that communion that Jeff read from Peter. He goes, if you develop this way, he goes, you'll never fall away. You want to talk about a promise of God? He goes, man, if you're developing this way, pursuing holiness, making every effort, he goes, you'll never fall away. But he says here, he goes, if you're running around thinking you belong to yourself and doing whatever you want to do with your body and your life, he goes, I'll destroy anyone who's destroying this temple. And that's exactly what happens here to Achan. He didn't take the people of God serious. He thought only about himself. He thought about what he saw. He thought about what he wanted. He thought about what he thought would give him pleasure. He woke up and thought, man, what can I do for my day to make my day easy? He got up in the morning and thought about himself. He got up in the morning and said, man, I got my security buried beneath the tent. Joshua goes, you brought trouble on all of us, and now the Lord will bring trouble on you. It's a promise of God. He goes, I'll destroy anybody who destroys this temple. You can think it's a joke if you want. Keep playing church. See what happens. I've seen it happen. I've seen it happen to people. Not taking the church serious. Only thinking about themselves. Let me just tell you guys, listen. Real treasure is never buried. It's never buried. It's never hidden. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Jesus goes, he's put his treasure in us. That the one who said, let there be light, has put this light in us. His spirit in us. This treasure in us. And he goes, it makes it clear that there's this power from him at work within us. And it's not from us. He goes, it makes it clear. Everybody can see it. Real treasure is never buried. Real treasure only comes from him. Real treasure is never buried. Real treasure, everybody can see it. It makes it clear that that we're not doing something. But that the power of the one and only living God is at work in us. And then the last thing here, the silver was buried deeper than the rest. Because beneath it all, just like Judas, who betrayed Jesus for some silver. See, beneath the robe that looked good, beneath the stealing, beneath the lying, beneath all that was the betrayal of the one and only living God. That's what's underneath all that. Just like Judas. And I would say learn a lesson from Judas. Because Judas betrayed Jesus for some silver. And afterwards, he was like, he took it and threw it back at the religious leaders. And he's like, this wasn't even worth it. It's too late. Gave birth to death. His death. See, the real crime here is the betrayal of Jesus and his glory and his name. This is what's lying underneath it all. And just so you don't think this is an Old Testament thing, in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 26, it says, dear friends, if we deliberately continue sinning after we have received knowledge of the truth, spoiler alert, you just got it. You are better off not to show up here tonight because now you've received knowledge of the truth. And he says, if we deliberately keep sinning after we've received knowledge of the truth, there is no longer any sacrifice that will cover these sins. There is only the terrible expectation of God's judgment and the raging fire that will consume his enemies. For anyone who refused to obey the law of Moses, Achan, thou shalt not covet, was put to death without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. That's what happened to Achan. Just think how much worse the punishment will be for those who have trampled on the Son of God and have treated the blood, the precious blood that we were singing about, who have treated the blood of the covenant, which made us holy, as if it were common and unholy, and have insulted and disdained the Holy Spirit, who brings God's mercy to us. For we know the one who said, I will take revenge, I will pay them back. He also said, the Lord will judge his own people. It is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. See, don't treat this as if it's ordinary and unholy. Don't treat this as if it's common and unholy. Don't treat these cups as if it's just Welch's grape juice and some goldfish. Don't leave here and deliberately continue sinning. Give glory to God by telling the truth. And we're going to break into our groups like we always do, and we're going to pray. You know, what an awesome opportunity to unbury some things. What an awesome opportunity to come forward. In whatever group you're in, with whoever you're with, and just expose that stuff. So you're not standing there at the end and trying to tell the truth only when you're caught. Because that's what will happen. Jesus says, you'll give an account. But that account at that time won't save you. It'll be too late. Let's pray. Thank you.